guys, it's Joe here, and in this video I will be reviewing and running these fine models from Atlas O. These are Atlas O gauge versions of the EMD GP35, and as you see, they come in the Rock Island paint scheme from the 1960s. The catalog numbers for these items are 1185-1 for the powered unit, and 1135-2 for the non-powered unit. The powered cab number for this model is 333, and the non-powered cab number is 331. The GP35 is a four-axle diesel-electric locomotive built by General Motors Electromotive Division between 1963 and 1966. The locomotive's power was provided by an EMD 567 D3A 16-cylinder engine that produced 2,500 horsepower, and it was turbocharged. Considered a yard and road switcher, these units were the workhorses of the railroads throughout the 1960s and 70s, and these units certainly are not strangers to the Rock Island Railroad. These Atlas O models are actually custom conversions done by JD Trains and are absolutely awesome on detail. Without a doubt, these units blow away MTH or Lionel's offerings. The level of detail on these models are astonishing. The powered locomotive features Lionel's TMCC and Lionel's Rail Sounds 4, and they are equipped with electrocouplers, lighted cab and number boards, LED lighting throughout, including directional headlights, directional classification lights that are displayed as red marker lights at the rear of the train, opposite of whichever end is going forward. The paint job is absolutely perfect. The markings are crisp, beautiful, and clean, and the placards are all legible. They come with molded ABS bodies, a punch press stamped metal chassis, die cast trucks, and die cast fuel tank, and front and rear operating electrocouplers. The powered unit weighs around 5.5 pounds, and the non-powered unit weighs around 4 pounds. Both models are roughly 15 inches long, coupler to coupler, and are true 1/48 scale in proportion. On the front, you will find lots of fine details, from separately applied windshield wipers, grab irons, sand bin filler caps, handrails, and safety chains. And on the pilot, the level of detail is mind-blowing. Here you can see the MU lines draped through the snow plow, a movable coupler cup bar, and even coupler detail as you see here. There is even an air brake line included. Also on the front and rear porches you will find folding walkway platforms. The trucks are masterpieces in their own right. They feature metal gears, axles, and wheels, separately applied details such as speedometer cable, brake cylinders, and the suspension spring retainers. The cast metal fuel tank is nicely done, and it houses the speaker for the Rail Sounds sound system. The rear truck is identical to the front truck. The back of the locomotive is just as nice as the front, with many of the same separately applied details. The steps have rail drainage holes, all very nicely done, and adds a nice touch. On top of the locomotive, there's lots of nice details to be found. Here's a nicely cast horn, many separately applied lift rings, there's an operating smoke unit, prototypical for Rock Island Jeeps, there is no dynamic brake fan detail, and at the rear there are moving cooling fans. Inside the cab there are two nicely done figures, and the mirrors also move. Unfortunately, Atlas has followed Lionel's thinking and replicated the mirrors as clear glass windscreens. This should not be, since windscreens are long gone and have not been around since a few of the first generation diesels carried them in the 1950s. These here on this model should be silver to replicate the mirrors. As mentioned earlier, all the lighting is LEDs and the headlights are directional. Interestingly, the number boards are also directional, only coming on at the lead end of the locomotive. The classification lights are directional and work only as red marker lights, only coming on at the rear of the locomotive, opposite of whichever end is going first. Finally, a look at the dummy engine reveals some fantastic features. There is definitely nothing dumb about this baby. The level of detail is outstanding and equal to the powered engines, and the lighting features are outstanding as well. In fact, there are four switches for the lights, two in the front and two in the back. You have the options of turning on or off the front headlight or rear headlight, and turning on or off the front marker lights or rear marker lights, depending on which direction you plan on having the dummy move. That is a really neat feature. Other than the mirrors being displayed as inaccurate clear windscreens, these models are absolutely the best GP35s on the market in terms of detail versus value. In fact, the only thing I wish these came with were MTH's Protosound 3 sound system instead of Lionel's TMCC. Okay, now that we have had a chance to review the details of these fantastic models, let's take them inside and try them out. Okay, so here I have the units inside and ready to go. But before we do that, there are a couple of features I'd like to point out about these locomotives. First, let's take a look at the underside of the trucks. Here is a look at the underside of the trucks, with the front truck being on the left and the rear truck being on the right. Notice there are two pickup rollers for each truck, ensuring positive electrical contact. On the left, you see the pickup rollers located in one position, and on the right, the rear truck, you see the pickup rollers are located differently. I have not seen this before. Also notice the traction tires for maximum grip. Also located on the bottom of the locomotives are the run program switch, the Odyssey control switch, and the smoke unit switch. On the dummy engine, these switches act as the light control switches. Okay, back at trackside, I'm going to fire the trains up. I'm going to run through a couple of the cab chatter options and then pull them out. Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
Well, that wraps up this review of the Atlas O 3-Rail GP35s. I appreciate you guys watching and supporting my work, and as always, please comment and subscribe. Take care, and we'll see you soon.